I thought, why didn't God make me this way? What if there's a different way? What if it's not the Great Commission that's the problem? Maybe it's that I'm listening to the methods. And what if there's more methods than I'm hearing?
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, we had a very insightful conversation last time with Dr. Mike Bechtle about what I believe are common misperceptions of evangelism, where some have thought we need to confront people with God's truth instead of befriending them and walking with them. Or we viewed nonbelievers as some kind of project or agenda item on our to-do list. Unfortunately, many Christians feel like our responsibility to evangelize is a burden, and we've completely lost sight of the relational part and what it means to live out our faith in tangible ways before others.
Yeah, I think you're right, and it seems like there's an aspect of fear as well. I might say the wrong thing or be ridiculed for my beliefs. And we also talked about introverts like me and extroverts like you and how that plays out.
Yeah, that's right, John. And the bottom line message from Mike is that you don't have to fit into some kind of prescribed pattern or formula to share your faith. God can use your unique personality and talents for his purposes. And all you need is a willing heart and a desire to love people well. If you missed part one of our conversation, check out the previous episode because this content is so encouraging and faith-building, and I'm looking forward to continuing the conversation with Mike about his book today, Evangelism for the Rest of Us, Sharing Christ Within Your Personality Style.
And you can learn more about Dr. Bechtle and his book when you click the link on your screen or give us a call. Now, last time, we included a Q&A session with our live audience, which was a group of young adults who served as summer interns here at Focus on the Family, and we'll hear more from them in just a little bit. Right now, Jim, here's how you started part two of the conversation with Dr. Mike Bechtle.
Mike, let's get very specific on this. You have attributes in the book that describe the extrovert. You're alluding to those things, but let's get real detailed on it, the extrovert and how they act and behave. And you're touching on it, but again, let's go a little deeper. Let me give you some data. And this is toward the introvert side, how God can use introverts. They tend to be 25% of the population, but they're 60% of the gifted population. And I see that. I have a boy, one of my sons, who is more introverted. Man, he can zero in on something. Neurobiology is what he's looking at right now. Man, he can tell me so much about it because he's read it. He wants to answer the questions that he has in his mind. He doesn't want to be an inch deep. He wants to be a mile deep when it comes to knowledgeable, study and all that. So, I mean, there is a great attribute to the introverts. We tease about it, but it's very true. They want to have the right answer, not just an answer.
Well, I think part of it is just how they operate. Most people think of extroverts as being loud and bold in some cases. Introverts are normally seen as being quiet and reserved, and that's usually not the case. They're not shy. That's a different issue. Introvert, it usually comes from where you get your energy. So extroverts, they get energy from being around people. And so you put them in a room full of people, their energy actually builds.
Yeah, the end of the party, they're actually
they're
on
pumped.
The roof.
Don't stop now.
Yeah, it's just getting started.
Yeah, and an extrovert walks into a party and they're thinking, how long will it take me to talk to everybody in the room? Whereas an introvert will go in and say, okay, what one or two people can I talk to for about 45 minutes each, and that'll be my evening.
Yeah.
And at the end of that event, they're just drained. It doesn't mean they don't enjoy it or they can't communicate well, which is interesting because most people think pastors tend to be all extroverts. Actually, a majority tend to be introverts because they have more of a sensitivity. They pick up quicker on what's happening around them. And it's just a matter of where they get their energy and how they use that. So it's a different ballgame. I'm the introvert. I'll go find a person. I can have a really deep conversation with them at a party, and we're both loving it.
Yeah.
And an extrovert will go in and just want to move from person to person and just loves it.
Right.
And there's needs on both sides there.
So. Yeah, and I guess that's one of the important disclaimers we have to give is that God has wired both. I mean, it's interesting to me that it's a set pattern, that there's not a third type in that regard.
Doesn't
There's introvert, extrovert, maybe somebody that can operate in the middle with some fluidity, but generally that's it. there isn't another type. God has wired this for a purpose.
Yeah, and I think there are different methods, because for an introvert to use the methods of an extrovert and vice versa, it's like an eagle telling a turtle how to move around. It's like, you don't want to learn from an eagle, you learn from another turtle or from another eagle. It's not that one's bad or the other one's good, but it's like being who God made us and then using that. That's why there's some real specific things for an introvert.
And in that regard, talk about the comment that is very common, which is, you know, I just don't have that gift. I don't have the gift of evangelism. And the Bible does talk about it in that way. Some will be teachers, some will be evangelists, etc. Certainly provides a big door for a person that struggles with evangelism to walk through. That's not my gift.
Well, I think it's how it's positioned, because I think introverts probably can do better at evangelism in a lot of cases. They're just not going to do it in the same way. And it's like, I don't go door to door. I don't go stand on the street corner. But there's other things that they can do. I mean, one example I had was that when I was in college, that's when I started writing. And I worked for the largest Christian publisher Sunday school curriculum in America. And I was doing their high school lessons. And this is back when they had dated curriculum. So on a particular date, every church in the country, there were about 60,000 churches using this curriculum. So they were all doing the same lesson. And so I was writing their high school curriculum. And once a quarter, they wanted the plan of salvation presented. And I remember that I knew what was happening each Sunday. One Sunday morning, I got up and thought, okay, I did the math. We had 60,000 churches that I had written this lesson for, with training for the teacher and how to present the gospel. Thought, okay, so 10 students was average back then in America, how many students were in a Sunday school class, a high school Sunday school class in America. So that means that morning, 600,000 people got to hear the gospel because of what I wrote. And I thought, what if 0.1% responded? So 1 out of 1,000 accepted Christ. That means that day I got to be a big part of leading 600 people to Christ. Now, that's what an introvert does. And is that less valuable than what an extrovert does? It's a different method. And I think to see the strength that comes out of that, that's why I've seen so many people just wake up to evangelism that are introverts when they realize they don't have to do it the way they were told, but God's equipped them.
When I like that idea that by all means, share the gospel. I mean, whatever gifting you have, whatever bent your personality is. In your book, Evangelism for the Rest of Us, you identify three ways that Jesus, let's go to the source, that Jesus modeled God's love for others. How did he evangelize, obviously? That's a great thing to do, is what was the example that Christ gave us?
I think we usually think of him with the multitude, but it's interesting, he didn't spend much time with the multitude, and he didn't go after the multitude. He hung out with his disciples. All these people started showing up, so it wasn't a prepared event. He spent most of his time, he had his disciples. That's where he put his focus and built into them. And of those, he had the three that he really involved with. And then those three went out and really changed the world. And so he invested one by one. And so he always cared about people. And then the idea that he met people right where they were. Think of the woman at the well.
Right.
He didn't start sharing the gospel with her. He talked about water. He was thirsty. She had the ability to get it. And then he started talking to her about her past and her family and those kind of things. So he met her at her point of need. It wasn't a project. It was a compassion type of thing.
Well, I was just going to say, the other thing too is that Jesus didn't seem to concern himself with how people responded to what he shared. I mean, he went right to it. And most people responded with, wow, this guy has spoken right to my heart. You know, the woman at the well is a great example. She ran to town saying, I think I've met the Messiah, right? Because he's shared with me he knows me even though he doesn't know me.
Yeah. Well, that's how he built trust, because he met her at her point of need. I think, what can we do to match that? Well, I'm not Jesus, but if I can build trust with someone through meeting where they are, the common ground, the real issues in their life, and just being there for them. Jesus had a lot of patience. He didn't force people to come to him. And I think if I can have patience to not have to push to try and wrap things up, but to be intentional. I mean, we are called to present Christ to people. And that comes, especially for an introvert, through relationships. When I can care and people know that, when I build that trust, it gives the foundation. So at a certain point, if someone is going through something really rough, who are they going to talk to? the person that they build trust with.
Yeah. Yeah. If they perceive that they're a project, then they're not going to come to you at a point of need.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so true, but I think this is one of the great weaknesses of the church today in modernity. It doesn't have time to develop those relationships.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And it's probably the greatest weakness that we have. You know, we're busy. We're all running around doing things, and we got meetings to go to and places to fly to, and we don't really stop to know our neighbor, to find out where their point of need is, right, to what Jesus did exemplify for us. And somehow we have to get control of that and understand what the eternal things are in this life, starting with your family, your kids, and then beyond that, your friends, and then your neighbors and people that God brings to the well in your life.
Well, and I think that goes back to your earlier question about what's changed now. Why aren't people sharing? And they used to. And I think part of it is, they tried, and it was never something people were comfortable with. It's easier to just stop doing it than to deal with the guilt. Mm. And now we're in a place where, after having not done it for a while, there's a lot of other things we can do.
Yeah.
And we get busy with things that are urgent, but they're not important.
Mike, I think one of the key things that I've experienced in my life is just be on the ready.
Yes.
You know what I mean by that? Mm-hmm. You never know when the Lord's going to present or bring someone across your path, and you just have to have an attitude of that antenna being sensitive enough to hear a point of pain, a question, whatever it might be. And there's so much going on in the news and everywhere else that you don't have to look very far to find a carrot, back to your daughter's analogy, that's ready to pick.
Yeah.
You know, you can identify somebody who's actually struggling, and then the sensitivity to actually ask questions like the Lord did that lead someone into an internal discussion. Right.
Yeah.
In their own head. Like, that's a good point. And that's great work if you can do that. Probably the most difficult people to evangelize are family members. Mm. They know you. They know your warts. They know when you came to Christ because you've told them 14 times. You may have even called the family meeting together to make sure you know where I'm coming from. And, you know, and that's all good. But they can be some of the most difficult people to win to Christ, for all kinds of reasons. So in that context, what advice or encouragement do you have for the family member situation?
You know, I think about the fact that we're supposed to pray for opportunities. We pray for our family members. But it's almost like when you read a book and it's got a scripture passage in it, we know it already, so we skip over it. When we hear that we're supposed to pray for our family members, we take that lightly and realize God is the one that is drawing people to himself. And so what do you do with family members? And I think they know where we're coming from, and we can still present when it's appropriate. But in Romans 2:4, it says that God draws people through kindness. It's his kindness that brings them to repentance. It's not the logic. And in a book like Romans, it's all logic.
Right.
And for him to say, what brings people to Christ? It's kindness. And to be able to build that into our relationship, to keep loving him, be intentional about kindness, be intentional about building the trust, the relationship, and still be intentional. But I think too often we get desperate because they haven't responded, so we try and do it even harder. It's like, maybe we just need to love them harder.
Yeah.
All right. At this point in the episode, we turned again to our live audience of students for a Q&A session, starting with this first question.
Hi, I'm Isaac Irvin from Indianapolis, Indiana. And my question is, so you've mentioned a few times the importance of relationships when sharing your faith. And I'm curious what your opinion is of cold evangelism, so approaching a stranger to have a spiritual conversation, but without really an intention to form a relationship, and if you think that there's still a place for that in Christianity today.
Good question. I think there is a place for it. For an introvert, it's not going to happen very often. For an extrovert, it could happen a lot more often, but I think it goes back to the need of the moment. That if God is nudging me to do that, and I've been in those situations where he says, that person, now. It's like, that's what obedience is. But in a lot of cases, if he isn't nudging me to do that, then there's a chance that I could turn somebody off based on just approaching him that way. When I was in college, I had a classmate that went out on the streets of downtown Phoenix, and he had a project he'd put together. He wanted to see how many women he could ask to kiss him before they would actually do it. And he just got him on the street, and he asked, I think he got to 98, and he got slapped, he got sworn at. But finally the 98th one said, okay, and she gave him a kiss. And the thought would be, well, that would be like cold calling, in a sense, cold evangelism, looking for a response. And, you know, you could say, well, it was worth it because of that one person did it.
One out of 100.
Yeah, but what about all the other ones who now are even more jaded and because of what happened there? So I think there's a place for it, but I want to be responsive first to what God asked me to do.
Yeah. Mike, you had a story about being on an airplane. This is so typical. Anybody that travels a lot,
we all have stories.
You get to that point where you just want to put the headset on and this is going to be snooze time or catch up on work time. And then you hear the Lord say, aisle three. Or whatever. What was your experience?
Oh, I had been leading a couple seminars for several days, and I was just exhausted. It was the end of the day, got on the plane, it was completely packed, and the only seat that was open was right next to me. And so I'm thinking, this is sweet. I don't want to talk to anybody. I want to put my head in the window and just go to sleep. And so I actually was thanking God for the fact that the one open seat was that. And then they opened the door of the plane again. And this man walked in. He was probably, I think he told me he was 85 years old. He was a Chinese man. And he stood at the front and he looked around and then he saw me. He saw the open seat. He smiled so big and I thought, no. And I thought, okay, I'm not going to share my fate with him. I'm not even going to talk to him. I'm tired. And I told God, I am not happy about this. And if you want me to talk, because I knew he was coming there, I said, if you want me to talk to him, you're going to have to make it so obvious.
So you're now into let's make a deal mode.
Yeah. And so he came and he sat down and got settled. And he turned to me. He goes, hello, you tell me God.
Oh, man.
And I said, what? He said, you tell me God. I said, you want me to tell you about God? He says, yes.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, now people are going, you got to be kidding me. Come on.
Well, I mean, it was okay, so this was kind of obvious, and I still was not.
Think? Yeah. That doesn't say much for, you know, your willingness to respond to God. He's got to talk to you that clearly.
Oh, I'm still grumpy, you know, about it right after that. And so I thought, okay, I'll talk to him. But I told God, I said, I'm not very pleased with you right now because you made it obvious. But we talked, and it turned out he flew quite a bit, and he was learning English, and he thought that was a good topic to bring up the talk. So we went through and spent the whole time. Of course, he was hard of hearing as well. So I'm having to almost yell answers as I'm
so everybody
sharing.
Else is
so the Lord has several aisles nearby ready to hear your great presentation of the gospel.
Yeah, and that was even worse for an introvert to have to yell the gospel in a plane.
It could have been intended for an entirely different person. Yes. You never know.
Well, we were just about to land and it had been quiet for a while. And as we're landing, I thought, I had a little copy of a tract, The Four Spiritual Laws, in my wallet. And I thought, I felt like God was saying, just give it to him. I'm going, no, I don't want to talk to him anymore. And I said, okay, if he says one more thing about God, I will give him the tract. And right before, I mean, we're almost wheels down, and he said, thank you for telling me God. Pulled out the tract, I handed it to him. And,
that's funny.
But it was because I had prayed in the moment, you know, show me what you want me to do. Now, that's cold evangelism, but it was because he told me to do it.
Yeah.
And I think that's what being responsive is and why prayer is so important, that we ask God to set things up and guide us into what he wants us to do.
All right, next question.
I'm Alex Seeley, and I'm from Arvada, Colorado. This one is more for Jim and John. We've talked a lot about how some people may have a negative perception of Focus on the Family. When you come into contact with these people, how do you go about dismantling that bias to make room for a relationship, especially as the faces of Focus and the broadcast?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, so often it's kind of that preparation that people have a caricature because of something they've heard from somebody else or, you know, eight people removed, and they really don't know because they don't know you and they don't know even really the organization. They haven't done that research. I think in that regard, one of the things, especially on the LGBTQ side, you know, Focus is unapologetically Christian in how we read the scripture. We're saying Jesus himself said, a man shall leave his mother and father, cleave to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So the design, the biological design of the human being, the spiritual, emotional design of the human being, I think is meant in that institution of the family, how God designed it, Does that mean we don't have compassion for people that fall outside of that? Of course not. We're, you know, I have friendships in that community of LGBTQ advocacy. And I've gotten to know a handful of those folks and listen to their heart, just like the woman at the well. And I think when people have that experience and I can share that experience with others, it turns their head. I mean, then they go, wow, okay, I had no idea. But the problem in the culture right now is just standing on traditional biblical themes is becoming so unfashionable that the culture is turning on that and ridiculing. And actually, an irony is that they're doing today what they, I think, thought of the Christian of the 50s and 60s doing. And they've turned that venom now, what they perceived happened back then, the bad attitude of the Christian community toward a variety of issues. But they've become that. You know, you can't speak on a college campus. So we've got to weather that. David Horowitz, I mentioned him. He wrote a book. He's not a Christian, but he wrote a book, How the Left is Killing Christianity in America. And he said, Jim, don't you realize you're in an alley fight and the other side has switchblades? I said, David, we get that. It's just we're not allowed to bring a switchblade to the fight. We've got to bring love, joy, peace, goodness, gladness, mercy, self-control. He goes, man, those aren't good weapons in an alley fight. And that's true. But this is what the Lord is calling us to do, to love people. And when you really love a person that's very set against their perception of who you are and what you believe, it's amazing how that heart can crack open. It's like the Lord has wired us. He knows our spiritual DNA. When somebody feels sincerity and love from another human being, it's almost irresistible to not open your heart up to that person. It just happens. I think that's what the Lord meant by love your neighbor. When you love your neighbor, it's like they cannot help but allow you in. And sometimes that's hard, and sometimes that's easy, but that's what God has called us to do.
I would observe that we're not celebrities. I mean, in some circles, I guess, there are people that know us, but I just assume most people don't know who we are or what we stand for. So I try to lead with kindness and with care, and I might tell somebody where I work later. We have new neighbors, and my wife exemplifies this, I think, really well. New neighbors, the woman was obviously pregnant, and my wife said, I'm going to make a meal for them. And she made two meals for them. Now, I don't know where they're at spiritually, and they're not a project. They happen to live a few doors down, so we're going to see them with some frequency. So at some point in time, it might come up where I work, but I prefer that that's not the deal. I'm not a focus person so much as I'm a follower of Christ.
There you go.
And so labels get messy. You know, we have preconceived notions, like Jim said. And if you lead with being caring and just trying to establish relationship, then it doesn't matter where you work. Oh, I thought you were at Focus. I thought you people were like this or that. Well, obviously we're not all like this or that, right?
So, and, you know, you're saying something that's really important. In talking to a couple of the LGBTQ folks that I've, you know, developed a friendship with, they actually thought we were all like Westboro Baptist. And I said,
now these are the people that go out and picket and make themselves onerous.
They picketed us a few years ago. Yeah. They're out on the curb here at Focus, you know, picketing Focus for our position, being too kind toward the LGBTQ community. So the point of that is that caricaturing that goes on, what you learn is nothing's monolithic.
Yeah.
They look at us as those people like Westboro Baptist. They think of that as Christianity. I have a real issue with that because I think it's devoid of Christian
love
and respect and those other things. But in the same way, we look at them in that way. You know, we don't understand that there are LGBTQ people who believe in religious freedom. But they exist, and they lift that up. But, you know, again, that's where dialogue really helps.
Hello. My name is Mackenzie, and I'm from Dover, Delaware. Early on in the broadcast, President Daly, you mentioned that...
President Daly, yay!
You mentioned that one of the reasons that young people might feel less comfortable sharing their faith with others is because it feels inappropriate. In my experience, some of this is a result of our society's turn toward relativism, or the idea that we shouldn't try to convince people of anything because everyone is allowed to define their own truth. Mm-hmm. So as Christians, how do we evangelize or share the truth with those who don't believe that a capital T truth exists?
Mm. Yeah, I think that part goes back to exactly what they were just sharing, which is about relationship. Because if I can have a neighbor and the issue isn't first those types of things, I build trust. I find out about their lives. I talk, I listen. We become friends. We become involved with each other. So they know that I actually care. You open the door to have those kind of discussions. Because it's not a matter of whether we agree or not. It's like if you are in a love relationship with somebody, you can disagree and still have that deep care for each other. And I think that's the foundation where I'd start.
Let me ask you this, Mike, because I've recognize sometimes when I'm engaging in a friendship or relationship, certainly you want that person that doesn't know the Lord to come to know the Lord. But in some ways, and I know people might be critical of this, you've got to put that kind of on the back burner for the relationship. And then again, let the Lord own the outcome.
Yeah.
If you put that at the front, like my goal and what I have to achieve here over some period of time, is this person needs to come to Christ. And that certainly is the desire. But if it becomes your mantra, if this is it, it can mess up the relationship in such a way that you do harm rather than good.
Yeah,
do you follow what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. But it becomes, the relationship becomes subservient to the project.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I don't want anybody to be a project because they know if you're treating them as a project.
Right.
It's like, but if I care about them, it opens the door at some point, especially when they're going through something hard, which they will.
Yeah.
I mean, I had a friend who was a pastor, and he said that if he was on an airplane, he could talk about all kinds of things with the person next to him. But if he brought up family, there was almost always an issue, and they would open up. And so, but he didn't just start talking about sharing his faith. He would talk about what was important to them. Family was usually a touch point because there's some pain in there someplace.
Do you think we've lost the opportunity to have an honest dialogue with somebody that doesn't, back to the question, see a capital T truth, even though we see it? I mean, is it possible for us to talk to people without getting all emotional? Is asking questions perhaps a good approach?
Absolutely. I mean, again, I think Jesus, what he did so effectively is he just laid it out there. Hmm. I mean, I don't see a lot of or hear a lot of emotion as he's talking to the woman at the well, the woman caught in adultery. Hey, whoever has no sin, let him cast the first stone. Mm. That is a brilliant stroke of having those people, probably mostly men, if not all men, look inside their own heart. And it's interesting to me, the oldest began to leave first. Mm. I mean, they got it because they lived life long enough to know, okay, we get what you're saying, Jesus. Even though they didn't appreciate it, I don't think, but they caught the point, right? And I think that's so much of it is that, again, we just need to lay that truth out there. And I think the irony is it does resonate. Truth is hard to bury. Hmm. So if it's given in a spirit of sincerity and love, I think people will think about it far longer than you probably think about it. You know, you may walk away from that encounter feeling like a failure. And I've had that happen where somebody has come all the way around years later and said, you remember you said that to me? And I was going, I don't remember. I feel horrible. But it meant something to them in that moment. Mm-hmm. And that's what you have to trust.
Well, the fact that it's not culturally acceptable to believe that there is truth doesn't mean there's not something inside everybody that senses it.
Yeah.
There was a broadcast. I mean, I live in Southern California. There was a news broadcast I was watching years ago. And they were interviewing an atheist about something that was going on. And he was talking about why it's ridiculous to believe in God. And an earthquake happened right then. You could see everything shaking and his eyes got, he's, oh my God, it's an earthquake. I thought, why did he say, oh my God? It's just natural that when there's a crisis, there's something inside that knows it.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's true. And even when you have calamity in this life, I remember 9/11, church attendance hit an all-time high of 93%. The following couple of weeks after 9/11. Isn't that interesting? I think when the chips are down, human beings do turn to faith to sort things out. And that's an indication, I think, of our heart. That's truth. when we're in trouble, we want to turn to God. We're wired to.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Ellie. I'm from Farmers Branch, Texas. And I just think scripture is so clear that we should surround ourselves with fellow believers, people who are going to push us in our relationship with God. But how do we avoid limiting ourselves to only those Christian circles so that we don't limit the spread of the gospel because we're comfortable?
Years ago, I taught at Biola University, and I had a class on evangelism and discipleship. And I gave an assignment that sometime during the semester, they had to have a conversation, not share their faith, have a conversation with two unbelievers. All I had to do was talk to them. And I thought it was a pretty simple assignment. At the end of the class, two girls came up to me in tears. They said, "That's not fair. We go to Biola. We don't know any non-Christians." I thought they were joking, but they were serious. They wanted to do a paper instead, have an alternative assignment. And I started thinking about it. I thought, okay, so we've gotten to that point. Howard Hendricks at Dallas Seminary used to say it takes the average new believer about 3 years to eliminate all the non-Christians from their life. Hmm. I'm teaching this class. I'm teaching at Biola. And then as I was listening to that, I realized I don't have any non-Christians.
Friends.
And that was one of the impetuses where God moved me into a corporate setting for the second half of my career because I wanted to be around. So I have far more non-Christian people in my life now than I do Christians. They're just friends. They're coworkers. They're colleagues. But that opens door for trust that they don't have those kind of relationships with other people. So I think it's really important to be not only just open, but to seek out those kind of relationships. But at the same time, have that strong base with your Christian colleagues and friends so that you get the encouragement to get the accountability, but also have the opportunity.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Kelly Conley. I'm from Mountain Home, Arkansas. And Dr. Bechtle, unfortunately, many of my close friends and family members that were once believers have since rejected their faith. And I know you mentioned when evangelizing to your family members, pray intentionally, show kindness. But what else can I do and how do I approach that when they already know the nuts and bolts of the gospel?
When they already know the gospel, they have turned away from it, is probably the time when a lot of believers have turned away from them as well. So they probably feel like, because I'm not doing that anymore, I've been rejected. They need somebody in their life that still accepts them and still loves them unconditionally, just the way they are. That's, I think, where the door gets open, to be able to have those kind of conversations and just be the person in their life that stayed with them. I think more than anything else, especially family members, I don't want to reject somebody because they rejected their faith. It's like, okay, that's what they did, but they're still the same person, and I still need to just love them to pieces.
I think, too, just living it out. At that point, you just need to live your faith so well that they see a difference. And that, to me, would probably be the best witnessing I could do in that context, because almost anything you say will be used against you in the family court. So I think living it well is probably your best way to build trust with that family member again, and then believe that eventually the Lord will give you that opportunity. That's certainly my wife's situation. She's the only believer in her family. So you can imagine her family, I think, sometimes scratches their head about us and what we believe, but she's living a very wonderful Christian witness in front of them and praying for them and loving them, and it's beautiful to watch.
Hi, my name is Matthew Wolf. I'm from St. Louis, Missouri, and I have a similar question. So you mentioned earlier it's very difficult to evangelize to family members, and my father is not a Christian, and he has told my mother and I, who are both Christians, that he does not want to be evangelized to anymore. So how do we go about that situation while still respecting their boundaries, especially with an immediate family member?
I think in that case, I want to be open and honest with them and have a real relationship. And that real relationship is going to talk about whatever's there. And I could even say, I know you don't want me to share anymore. You know where I'm coming from. It's part of who I am. In fact, it is who I am. It's my life. To not share with you what's happening with me is disrespectful to you. It's not part of a real relationship. So I work on the love side of it. I look on the work on the relationship side. But I will still share things God is doing with me or the experiences I'm having just to share my story. I will respect his not wanting me to tell chapter and verse and you need to come to Christ. He knows all that. I just want to love him, but still live that in front of him, just like you shared.
Yeah.
Because that's my opportunity to use my story.
Yeah. As you're unfolding your life to that person, you can certainly weave in, you know, God did this. You can weave in prayer and, you know, answers to prayer and a spiritual perspective without evangelizing, so to speak. And I think for me, that's a pretty safe way to go, is to meet them where they're at. But as I share about what's going on in my life, to your point, Mike, it's not devoid of all God talk.
Yeah.
I can't do that.
In fact, what I probably would say is, okay, I will stop evangelizing you, but now it's going to be even worse because I'm going to pray for you. And so God's going to come after you in his way. He said, you're not getting out of this. I won't say anything, but now you've really got some pressure.
You know, I'd have a little different take on it in that all those things are true. But I do think if your father's in that place, the best thing you can do is be the greatest son you can be. Mm-hmm. And let that speak for itself. Because I think when he's on his deathbed and you're next to him, that's what he'll talk to you about, is you've been the greatest son a father could have. Mm-hmm. And then you could say, it's because of my faith in Christ, I wanted to honor you. And that'll be powerful. Mike, this has been so helpful. Wow, good stuff. It's a little outside of the normal discussion that we have here in Focus on the Family, but what a wonderful reminder that we need to be intentional about sharing our faith, not take the bait of the culture that we can't or shouldn't share our faith. I encourage young people, man, you have heard some great comments from young people here. That's why I have so much hope. Those were wonderful questions. And I think the bottom line is share the gospel within your temperament, within your talent that God has given you. That's what you're saying, Mike. Mm. And I hope you'll pick up a copy of Mike's book, Evangelism for the Rest of Us, right here from Focus on the Family. The great news is every penny goes right back into ministry. I don't think that works with the other online retailers. And, you know, help the ministry out. Get a copy of Mike's great book. And also save a marriage, help a parent do a better job, save a baby's life. I think that's worth it. And we'll say thank you for that gift by sending a copy of Mike's book.
Donate today and get your copy of Evangelism for the Rest of Us when you call 800, the letter A and the word family, or click the link at the bottom of your screen. And if you are listening along or watching and thinking, I don't know even with this Jesus stuff, I don't even know where to begin to know what to think about Jesus, call us. We have resources. We have a little booklet called Coming Home that we can send you. It's online as well. We want you to know the person that we've spent the last half hour or so talking about, Jesus. Again, our number is 800, the letter A, and the word family. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.